The genocide against the Tutsi 25 years ago, we made a choice as a government, as a community. We made the choice to rebuild our country, to all be committed around unity and resilience with the support of good partners we've had. I would say we are doing good. We are somewhere in terms of reducing maternal and newborn mortality, but most importantly, with regard to easy access to quality health services, especially at primary health care level. But there is a long way to go, but we are proud of the results we have so far. That right. is what we are sharing with other countries today.
Yeah. Honorable Minister, of course, we're still looking at Rwanda being one of the few countries on the continent to actually champion primary health care. And that is rather a very great job. But speak to me entirely on the universal health coverage. We still saw the country registering progress on the same. Only Rwanda and Ethiopia, actually, among the 54 countries, have registered growth on that. We're still seeing a lot of investment happening in countries like Kenya, also around East Africa. But for Rwanda, a country that is actually one of, you know, the emerging economies, still not even middle class yet. How do you manage to hit such a target way ahead of everyone else? And when we also understand that financement is one of the biggest hindrances to universal health coverage, how do you do that?
Yesterday, our President Kagame, was awarded by AMREF. Right. Following an assessment that was conducted by AMREF and other stakeholders, who was awarded as a champion of universal health coverage. And they considered what has been done under his leadership. And one of the criteria they were looking at was actually universal health coverage, financial accessibility to health services, and they looked at the system we have here, the mutual or community-based health insurance scheme that is covering 91% of our people. And this is a great achievement because today Rwandans are not fearing to go for to seek for health services at health facility level. 91% of our women are delivering at health facility level. They are no longer delivering at the community. And more than 93% of our kids are fully vaccinated. And we have also more than 93% of young girls that are receiving cervical cancer vaccine. Also, we have a good coverage of mosquito net. More than 70% of Rwandans are sleeping under a mosquito net. Those are criteria that were looked at before awarding our president as a champion of universal health coverage. I will also mention the community health care workers model we have. These people, last year we had 45,000 of them. Managing health promotion, but also diagnosis of malaria, diarrhea, and pneumonia at the household level, but also treating moderate cases of malaria, pneumonia, and diarrhea, but also offering family planning methods. So this model is quite unique. We have also Ethiopia that is implementing the same model. Even Ethiopia yesterday was awarded for this achievement around primary health care. So community health workers, treating people at the community level, but also focusing on health promotion and prevention of infectious diseases, existence of a strong insurance scheme that is reducing the financial hardship, the out-of-pocket people have to pay before getting health services. Those two are strong pillars of the health system in Rwanda, but also in Ethiopia. But I will also mention other countries that are doing good, that are catching up, like Ghana and Kenya, Senegal. They are also building their own health system with much emphasis on health insurance.
Right. Doctor, again, something that we're looking at here is that if you look at statistics from, say, the World Bank or the United Nations, it indicates that one physician takes care of at least 1,000 patients, and that's quite impossible. not even in our lifetime. So I just want us to understand, when you're looking at the need for medical doctors on the continent that is north of millions of people, what are we doing right now? What kind of strategies are we putting in place to actually make healthcare affordable, but also accessible at the same time being quality? How are we going about it as a country?
Yeah, I want to speak about doctors because I believe and my government believes that primary health care is critical. And when I look at community health workers, actually for me those are doctors at the ground level, right, at the household level. And today we have increased the number of community health workers from 45,000 up to 58,298, right, community health workers. That means one community health worker is taking care of 27 households. This is universal health coverage. Right. If you have 27 households that are taken care by one skilled health provider, this is good. And we have also chosen to focus on prevention, because the more you prevent diseases, the better. You will spend less money to high-level hospitals, hospitalization of people, and you will also avoid complicated cases. So that's why I keep insisting on primary care, but it doesn't mean we don't need doctors, we don't need specialists, because you will never be able to prevent diseases at 100%. You have some cases that will escape, and that's why we really need specialists like cardiologists, nephrologists. Today we have a trend of non-communicable disease that is becoming actually a public health issue, and we are now engaging a lot in the prevention of non-communicable diseases, but also in building the capacity of our doctors. So there is a need to train more specialists, and the government of Rwanda is working on this. The University of Rwanda, we are also opening doors to private sector. We are having private universities that are opening their doors. I will mention the example of the UDHE, University of Global Health Equity, that will very soon open doors to medical courses. So this is a need also in country and in Africa.
Right.
We have a shortage of specialists, but we are working on it.
According to